Hi there, welcome to Sinister Inclinations, the horror show. My name is James Sato, I'm one of your hosts. To my right is my co-host, Terry Sherwood.
Hello everybody, good afternoon, good evening, depending on what time zone you're in. Thanks for joining us.
So, we recently did Sinister Inclinations live.
Yes,
at the Calgary Comic and Entertainment Expo. Did you enjoy the experience?
Yeah, I did. There were some niggly points to it and everything. I think we've gone over that ourselves, and the convention people were very receptive in listening to it.
Well, that's good.
You know, there's always corrections to be made, but overall, it was a positive experience. We got to meet some pretty cool people.
Yes.
Yeah, we got to see a lot of the people that were on the show that you'll be seeing later on, gave some very interesting questions, got some audience involvement with things, and I would suggest that it was a positive experience.
Yes, and as far as the Entertainment Expo went itself, I didn't spend as much money as I normally do, but there wasn't a lot of horror guests this year, and Michael J. Fox canceled, unfortunately, because he had to go have surgery. I met Chris Sarandon from Fright Night, Child's Play. He played Prince Humperdinck in The Princess Bride. Very nice fellow. We discussed business. And of course, he'd be very interested if I was to hire him to come up to Canada.
Oh, okay.
Well, they all are if you give them the money, right? But no, very nice fellow.
Does he play arena football?
No, he doesn't.
Oh,
no,
okay. That would be my big question.
I forgot to ask. Yeah. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
So apart from that, that was really the only money I really spent this year. I did go and get there was a place that prints any picture that you want on a cell phone case. So of course I got myself my own Blood Mania cell phone case.
Oh, it's right side up too.
Yeah, it is. Well, I could make it upside down.
That was for the people in Australia. You know, we have the upside down version.
So
I in turn spent money, but it was a completely different thing. I was a comics person, and I went there and I bought four issues of starting at issue 247 of Superman, which has always been a favorite of mine. Got a wonderful deal on them too. Person was very receptive, very forward thinking in it. I wanted to see DC artist Jim Lee, who was there. Mm-hmm. And we were presented, Rose and I were presented with this surprise gift of attending a, I guess you could call it a draw-a-thon with him, in which he, two-brained, I don't know how these guys do it, he's sketching these wonderful illustrations of Catwoman and other superheroes, and he's talking about his childhood and answering questions from the audience. Like, how do you do that? And it was just amazing. He's sitting there, he's doing this, and then he just peels them off, and he was going to give them away.
Wow. So, did you get one?
No, I couldn't even come close. I was here, and he was way over there. But by the time, because it was a spur-of-the-moment thing for us to get this, and we had to be in place by 2:30, and it was about 10 of 3 when we got there, because it was just spur-of-the-moment. On it. But it was still a wonderful experience listening to what he said about his childhood, how he got started, advice, things that were going to happen to the characters that he works on. He's also associate publisher of DC Comics. And keeping in line, they do horror titles. There's a horror title of Vertigo, their Vertigo imprint does many things. But all in all, yeah, it was a pretty cool experience. I've never seen anything like that before.
Okay. Well, yeah, I just went the one day. There was about 50,000 people there during the day, and it was kind of like you're packed in like sardines, and I walked the vendors area looking around for any horror-related stuff, and I'm sad to report that there wasn't a whole bunch of it this year.
No, not even horrible food. Did you try some of the food?
No, the lineups were so big I'd have to stand there for 90 minutes just to get a hot dog or something.
No, And that's the length of a film sequel in today's world.
Yeah,
90 minutes.
Yeah. I mean, seriously though, I didn't even stand in line to get a bottle of water until 4 o'clock, and there wasn't even that much of a line at that point. But that's when the lines subsided to the point where you wouldn't have to wait at least an hour. So, yeah. In a way, that was really kind of rough, especially when you're walking like all over the Big Four building and all over the convention center itself. So.
Yeah, some of the stuff was a bit spread out from the past. Mm. Like, it used to be a little bit more localized in certain areas. The artists particularly were located up in a building, another building, you had to go up some stairs to, and they all were there.
Mm-hmm.
Like, the placement was a little odd sometimes when you wanted to go in. Because you have, well, one guy's over here and the other guy's over there, and they're all supposed to be related because they're with the same company, but all spread out. Mm-hmm. And
I did have a chance to meet with my friend, Nat Jones. Mm-hmm. He does the zombie comic 68, which is an exceptional comic. If you're into the, you know, zombies in the Vietnam era, 1968. And he was sitting there doing some illustrations himself, which mm-hmm. was kind of cool. I see Nat at all, you know, all kinds of Alberta conventions, so it's very nice to see him when I do. Yeah, so that was my experience. So we're going to go to the footage that we took at the expo. But before we do, have you watched any interesting films or series or anything?
Yeah. Drifting back, The Driller Killer, which. You know, I was expecting, you know, a lot, you know, the title kind of gives it away, you know. But some of the footage that was shot in New York, circa, I believe it's 1978, I think it is, 78, 79. I saw one of the original punk new music clubs, Max's. It used to be Max's Kansas City, actually where Andy Warhol held court. And they have the front of that in there. The storefront of that in there, and it was still up. And I thought, that is pretty cool, because you can't go there and find it now.
No, it's anymore. Like Plato's Retreat.
And it's gone.
No way.
It's gone. And Plato's Retreat.
Plato's Retreat, yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Before there was Sato's Retreat, there was Plato's Retreat.
Oh, yes. Mm. And is that any relation to Dana Plato?
No, I don't think so.
That's just totally different strokes, right?
No,
that was pretty good. And I don't even
have
writers.
It was right next door to Plato's stepchildren, run by them.
Oh, yes.
So you enjoyed The Driller Killer?
Yeah, I did. Just because of, I took it for what it was. Really, kind of an interesting story of an artist that goes nuts. There's a surprise. Because he lives below a punk band that's rehearsing, and they just drive him
to the point where he kills
with the drill, and it actually was a really good band too. They were a real band called the Roosters, and because when these guys played, the guitarist when he played, you went, yeah, this is not, you know, we're just trying to dink around with the guitar and try to be it. This was a real thing. I saw that. I cast my mind back and I watched Halloween again, mm-hmm. the original. Nightmare on Elm Street and Friday the 13th, all the very first ones.
Oh, I watched Friday the 13th on, predictably, Friday the 13th. I've watched parts 1 and 2 again. The ones where there was no Jason at that point.
It was Bernie Perrant. Are those hockey people out there? Jacques Plante.
Largely American, I think.
Jacques Plante behind it all. It's the French version.
But I watched Beyond the Gates, which is a great film. I watched The Final Girls, which was a superior film. Well acted. They spent money. They perfectly had they made almost a perfect 80s throwback film, except for one thing, no blood.
They didn't have blood in the 80s?
No. Well, no. They weren't gory like the 80s films. Oh. You would suspect that if you were going to make a film like that, and I'm not sure if we discussed this at the Comic-Con or not, but if we rehash it, sorry. But that was the biggest thing. A very inventive premise. where these folks actually go into an 80s, these youth go into an 80s horror film and live it. And it's roughly based on, you know, Jason Voorhees. But the killings, there's no blood. You go, well, that's wrong. That's so wrong.
That was sort of like, though, the original, the Friday the 13th and Halloween's and everything. There was blood, but not a lot.
Well, Friday the 13th, I mean, it was pretty inventive. That was Savini. Yeah. That original throat slashing that gets discussed at the panel.
Yeah, we
do. I mean, that had never been seen on screen before, really. I mean, it was something brand new. So, you know, that was kind of a benchmark. That, and I always say that that particular scene and the entire film Dawn of the Dead by Romero were the ones that just showed me what gore could actually do.
Really? You know? Not the original Living Dead, 68?
No. No, they didn't have a whole bunch of gore. It wasn't until Dawn.
The sausage eating?
Well, we're talking like, you know, I mean, Dawn of the Dead, Day of the Dead, when you get, you know, like Sergeant Rhodes being ripped in half and things like that. You know, that was revolutionary. I started to watch, and I'm going to get this wrong, but it's a new Day of the Dead film. I was watching it on Netflix. And
the Afternoon of the Dead?
Yeah, it's just afternoon. Yeah.
I love that.
And I got halfway through, and I saw where it was going. I'll end up watching it, but it's not my cup of tea, and I'll probably end up reviewing it for my zombie review site. But
do you want to do our one we were talking about off camera? Remember that one we had the idea for? The Laughing Dead?
Oh, The Laughing Dead.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, that would be a good full trailer.
Yeah, I think that would be cool. People coming out of the ground.
Like Frank Gorshin in Batman. Yeah, laughing hysterically and shit. Yeah.
Yes, and then falling apart.
Yeah, you hear them coming.
Yeah.
You know, it could be like A Quiet Place in reverse. Yeah. Where everybody's quiet, trying not to gain attention, and you hear this laughter, and like, oh, we're fucked.
Yeah. All these dressed in tuxes.
Shambling down the street laughing.
You know, there's Billy Crystal, you know. You can have cameos of talk show hosts. You know, you can get, you know, Mr. Kimmel, you know, Billy Crystal, Dave Letterman, you know.
I think
we're going to do this, you know, if we're not.
I think it might be more apropos to have movie critics do it.
Yeah. So, yeah, that's just a silly tangent. I don't know where that came from. What else did you see?
Oh, well, I've been watching a couple of Paul Naschy werewolf films. I went back to that. I watched Wolfman and the Yeti, which actually spent a lot of time on the Video Nasties list, mm-hmm. primarily for just one scene where there's some skin that's cut off somebody's back. And it's so obvious in a 70s film that, you know, this is not what it is.
That's Driller Killer was in that, the Nasties list too.
Yeah.
When it came out.
Yeah, and Maniac was as well. Yeah. I watched that, and I watched The Werewolf and the Vampire Woman.
The feminist story.
Okay. Yes. And they're very good films. They're very atmospheric, and you know, they were shot on quite a budget, these Spanish films. And they're so 70s, you know, they've got the pacing and everything else, where it's not just, you know, so cliched anymore.
It's like Coffin Joe.
Yeah.
Coffin Joe things. What is it? I drink your blood, I eat your skin, or something like this, or I can't remember some of his titles. I probably got that one wrong. I'm the possessor of your soul, or something. All of these things that he did.
Yeah.
But Naschy made about like 3,000 films, didn't he, or something? Like,
actually, Naschy, there's a book that he wrote, an autobiography. I think it was Memoirs of a Wolf Man or something. But I'd like to see if that's in public domain at all, or who he'd have to pay, because I'd like to actually do a Paul Naschy film. Because he led a very interesting life, as most European men do with, you know, lovers and whatever else, and was a devoted horror fan. I mean, he loved making horror movies. In fact, he loved one film so much, he remade it three times. He remade the same film three times. And later on, I mean, I watched The Tomb of the Werewolf, which was quite contemporary. It had Michelle Bauer in it as Elizabeth Bathory, the character who keeps showing up in these films. And Paul was 70 years old at the time. Mm-hmm. And he had, you know, gained, well, some weight, as some 70-year-old men do. So
a polite way to say it.
Yeah, so, yeah. You know, a more stout werewolf.
Stout werewolf.
Yeah.
There's the premise for a film.
Can't really chase you down, really.
Yeah, you just can't, you know, come on back. I can't chase you. I'll just eat my arm, you know, because it's so good.
It's like a Wile E. Coyote setting traps and shit.
Yeah, take out my Acme coffin. Yeah, now we'd have some fun with that. The stout werewolf. Who would have thought? We didn't.
Well, what else do I have? I've watched so many lately that it's so hard to just, you know, bring them to mind again. I rewatched John Dies at the End, which not necessarily a horror film per se, but I mean, I just love it. It's such a good film. I rewatched The Final Sacrifice. For those of you who've ever seen The Final Sacrifice, it sat on the bottom of Rotten Tomatoes for, well, probably as long as Pink Floyd's Dark Side of the Moon stayed on the top of the charts. It was shot here in Calgary. I think we discussed that with Mr. Trainer.
Yeah, we did. Yeah. He was kind of hung his head a little bit.
Well, it made a household name out of Zap Rowdowser, the character.
Oh, I thought.
Yeah, and the actor who portrayed Zap, Bruce Mitchell, passed away last week. And I'd spoken to Bruce on occasions. Very nice man. I didn't know him the way Stuart Bentley did. They were, you know, they acted together and that kind of thing. But he was all willing to do a little bit of a sequel to The Final Sacrifice, mm-hmm. and recreate the character many years later. But we'd just like to say to his family, to his friends, that we're very sorry at his passing.
Yeah, because there's not many, you know, the horror genre, well, any entertainment genre, it obviously loses people. And we don't actually want them to go, because we always have them in our minds, you know, what they were in their roles. Mm-hmm. You know, as young men and young women, you know, as the years, and we don't realize the years, and other things take the toll. And you do pass on, unlike what perhaps you played on the screen.
And there's no coming back.
No, you don't get a sequel.
Shouldn't be laughing about that.
Yeah, no,
no sequel for you.
You don't get it. You don't get a sequel. You know, you don't get a bigger budget either when you come back.
No, that's true.
You know, so it's. So what about? Have you done any like reading of stuff? Like
no? Not really. No, I haven't read a horror novel in some time.
I think I mentioned I passed you that copy of Kim Newman's book, Nightmare Movies.
Yes. Oh, okay. Yeah, I was glancing through that on my computer.
Yeah.
Reading passages. But no, to sit down and read an actual horror novel, I don't think I have since Jack Kilbourne's first novel. And, you know, because he was supposed to be the new Richard Layman, and, you know, he was not really that good.
If anybody out there in the viewing audience has a suggestion for a novel to read, or a book on film, the horror film today, should speak more of today. I've been going through the Nightmare Movies, the book by Kim Newman, which is just wonderful. Like, what an overview of everything. as you may have noticed in terms of the chapters and things and insightful comments. Mind you, you know, some of it's skewered a little bit perhaps to his personal views, but I've learned a lot.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, it's very comprehensive.
And you know, it's very fast read. It's mm-hmm. some of them can be drudgery, you know, when you're very dogmatic and you're there's a lot of humor in it. And kudos if anybody can get a copy of it's called Nightmare Movies. It's by Kim Newman. I think it's in a reprint edition now. It's second edition, and it's well worth it. But if anybody out there has a suggestion for another one to read for something like that, please don't keep it to yourself.
Yeah, email us, let us know, and we'll highlight it on the show.
Yeah,
I read a lot of like the short stories, like Melanie McCurdy, another fellow who used to actually, at one point, be an assistant of mine with Diabolik Films. James Brown has two books out called The Glads, 2 D's.
Oh, I'm not saying anything about that name.
Oh, no, that's what I thought. I put that on Facebook. Hey, yeah. James Brown is my personal assistant.
Free James Brown. I guess you can't now.
The hardest working man in the casket.
Yeah. I feel good.
I feel dead.
Now we're going to go up. Mr. Brown's lawyers will come after us for that one. But, it was all in fun. He was a good musician.
It was
actually
good fun.
Great musician.
Yeah,
great musician.
Oh, fantastic.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, we poke, but of course we poke fun, Mr. Brown's attorneys.
Yes. And now, I shouldn't have said that because I've also, in a non-horror thing, I've watched sections of the Hermits movie, Hold On. And one of their songs is Mrs. Brown, You've Got a Lovely,
lovely daughter.
And that just clicked into my head.
Oh, no, now
Mr. Brown's attorney.
And now it's clicked into my head. Mr. Brown, you've got a mean attorney.
Me daughter. Eternities. No, Eternities, there's one. Yeah. Attorneys are you, but something rare.
Oh,
life
man.
Goes on.
Now we're on a tangent.
Yeah, we're on a tangent. Let's bury that one.
Actually, you know, this is not really horror related, but the best series that I've seen on television lately is Cobra Kai, the television series based on The Karate Kid. Ralph Macchio returns. And
is he in it?
Yeah. He plays Daniel LaRusso. Yeah. Takes place 35 years later.
Is it last time I saw him, he was on an episode of Comic Book Men.
Oh,
he came into the store.
I think I saw him. I was walking past the television one night when my aunt from Winnipeg's down, and she loves Dancing with the Stars. And there's Ralph Macchio cutting the rug, so to speak.
Cutting the rug. Okay.
Yeah.
Well,
so,
cool.
Yeah, no, I thoroughly enjoyed that. And if you want to feel like you're back in the 80s, because they really pay homage to that era, you know, it's like just going right back. Because his nemesis, Johnny, who he beat.
The blonde guy?
Yeah.
Okay, see there too?
Yeah. He plays.
Same guy?
Yeah, same guy.
Wow.
Yeah, and it deals with their families and kids and the rivalry still and all that. So, yeah,
really?
it's very good.
Does he wax cars still?
Like, actually, it's been in the trailer, but.
Yeah. There's no Mr. Niyagi there, is there?
No, they pay a nice tribute to. He goes and visits the grave of Mr. Miyagi, and you know, it's dedicated to Pat Morita at the end.
That's good. Pat, yeah, because Pat Morita originated it. So.
Yeah. But there's a scene in you see, because Johnny goes back and he opens up Cobra Kai, the dojo, where, you know, that was the competition. And he's got a student doing all the shit work, you know, washing the windows and stuff. And it's like, hey, Sensei, is there any way you want me to wash these windows? No, I don't give a shit. But, it's a great series.
Windows? We have windows?
Yeah. And I binged watch it and just went, okay, now I got to wait a year. Fuck. Have you seen The Terror?
The series?
Yeah.
No, I haven't, because I kept thinking of the Roger Corman picture, which is still pretty cool.
Yeah, well, this is based on a Dan Simmons novel, and it revolves around an expedition into the Arctic, trying to find the passage by two British Navy ships, 1848. And, of course, they get frozen into the ice, and there's...
Who would have thought?
A creature, and that kind of thing. But, you know, it's funny, I was looking on Facebook, you know, and there's an article, you know, I don't know, IndieWire or somebody going, you know, last night's episode of The Terror, let us know why it's the scariest show on TV. And I watch the episode and go, well, not really.
No, the news is scary to me sometimes.
Yeah. Well, to see, the thing is, I mean, I love that period in British Navy stories. You know, I'm a huge fan of, you know, Horatio Hornblower, and Master and Commander was a great film, I thought. But with that, I think we'll take you now to the Calgary Comic and Entertainment Expo and Sinister Inclinations Live.
Yeah, close your eyes and you're there. This is a section of Sinister Inclinations that I like to call graphic horror. What I'm going to be talking about today is a comic release by a publisher, IDW, which is called Haunted Horror. Believe me, for those of you who are huge fans of the EC comic tradition, this particular book has been going on for 33 issues. What they actually do in the story is they will actually cull classic stories from various horror comics of the 50s, place them in one volume, and they call it the Haunted Horror. They can do 6 to 7 stories, all from different ages, usually into about the 50s. For instance, in Haunted Horror number 33, it opens with Gadzooks. Haunted Horror number 33 is an obnoxious cavalcade of shivery, spookin' killer kooks. An insane issue, literally bursting with issues. Weird, wild women, maniacal madmen, murder and monsters, and even a visit from an Edgar Allan Poe classic, tantalizing, top-tiered terror, guaranteed to make you bleed. Hey, 54 pages? I think it runs maybe about $5 in Canada. Well worth it. Check it out at your comic store. It's issue number 33. It's called Haunted Horror. Dig it up today.
What if he's okay?
What do you mean?
I mean, not dead.
It's been 7 months. If he's out there, it's not our problem anymore.
Look at this place. Your dad really did a good job keeping it up, huh?
Yeah, well, not much could pull him out of here.
Do you have Dad's keys to the office?
What do you think's back there?
Guess we'll find out.
This is momentous.
Shut up.
Curious viewers,
we found this like weird, probably banned VCR game. It's like a board game, you know, but you gotta watch it.
Obtaining the four keys allows passage beyond the gates. Only there can your father's soul be saved.
Did you just hear that?
Where did you say you found this again?
Hey, did you try to get into the house last night?
Why? Did someone try and break in?
I felt like somebody was watching us.
Look, maybe you need to take a break from this for a while.
We think our father bought this from your store. What if we just stopped?
I'm not gonna stop until we find Dad.
And I suggest you play the game.
Where the hell did this come from?
Find your father, take the final key, and become one with your new reality.
That lady was smoking hot. I think I want it.
Sure is now.
Hello, everyone. By the way, we are recording this today, so... if you come up and ask a question, there's a good possibility you're going to be on one of the on YouTube, on a podcast or Vimeo or any other social media. If you have a problem with that, don't come up to the microphone. You can ask questions from where you are, and normally we can hear you. So, but if you do come up to the microphone and you're brave enough and it's a cool question, we've got some giveaways for you. So,
and
one of a kind stuff.
You can feel free to come forward too, if you so desire, and the camera will make you look complimentary. It's how you feel.
Yeah, we've got it set to thin mode.
But we have to do the formatted intro. I'm Terry Sherwood. I write a classic film blog, and I've done some stuff for TCM. I've been to the TCM Film Festival three times as a media, had media access. But this is a horror show, so we're going to be talking about horror film. More importantly, horror media. Because it's a lot out there. It's strings. We're at a comic expo right now. And hey, there's comics, there's visual arts, there's film, there's motion picture, there's television. Everything gets to be covered in here. And Jim, it's our seventh show.
Seventh.
Our seventh show. The Seventh Veil is here. This is the seventh edition of Sinister Inclinations.
Right. My name is James Sato. I'm one of the hosts. I am the CEO of HGB Entertainment Limited. I'm a film producer. I'm the producer of Herschel Gordon Lewis's Blood Mania. Recently nominated for Best Independent Film at the Rondo Awards, and currently nominated for Best Film by the Alberta Media Production Film and Television Industry. So I read a blog called James Sato's Zombie Movie Reviews. You can find, if you're so inclined, they're very sarcastic. You can find those just by Googling it. Zombie movie reviews, blogspot.com, whatever.
This is a pretty off the shackle program too. So, anything sort of flies. We tend to go off on tangents, which is okay because you can bring us back, or you can go off on a tangent too and we'll bring you back. And not in a paper bag either.
So this is kind of an interactive thing like we did last year at the expo here. We want your opinions. We get up and we talk about the horror industry, and we like to know what horror fans are thinking. So any questions you have regarding any aspect of horror, whether it be music, we have a horror novelist here who can answer questions. Feel free to ask anything. Well, let's start this way. Who out there has a favorite horror film from 2018 so far?
Be it in the theater or on video.
Quiet Place. Yeah. Good.
Thank you. I was just raving about that. I thought it has the makings of a modern classic, the closest thing I've seen to one within the last, say, 5 years, 10 years. It's so impactful. What did you particularly like about it?
The silence. Other than people eating popcorn, I mean, it was a pretty quiet audience, and just that was a hard sell, I think, probably for the studio.
Did you tap the guy on the shoulder in front of you and say, "Don't eat that popcorn so loudly, you'll draw them here"?
Did you jump? Did they all jump when I don't want to spoil it for people that will see it. When the action occurred? Do you think there was the obvious setup for the sequel?
And they already approved it, I understand.
Yeah. I hope they do it the same. Well, I guess it's not going to be the same way. I'm not going to say too much about it because I don't want to spoil it for people, definitely. But for those of you who don't know, it's actually a Paramount bought the spec script, and it's mostly done in American Sign Language with visuals. And occasionally there are words, there are muffled words, And the music, like you say, fits the shots, the composition, the story. What can you say? It's like a slow creeping paralysis when you see it in the theater, and all of a sudden it's like, what am I seeing? And then, bang. Yeah. Wow. Congratulations. You have good taste. Whoops. Oh, it was. I think it's an invasion story, isn't it?
They kind of jump right into it. I think it's 90 days airborne starts.
Yeah. I wonder if it's 90 days. If it's like it's a homage to what is it? 90 days later, the Irish picture or something. Sorry. Oh, yeah, it was not that. It could have been, so.
Yeah, it's 28, but.
Yeah, 28 days, 90 days. That's my probation period. Most people's, but.
You know, it's funny, before there was the plethora of zombie films out there that there are today, I wrote a script called Alone. And the premise of that was, it starts off with the usual zombie outbreak, but a family's out camping. And it's the story of a young boy who has to, his parents get attacked. He's the one who survives. So we follow his journey as he becomes almost feral again, because he's only like 5 years old. So he has to survive on his own, and it starts to bring out the old human in him, the survival instinct. No dialogue until maybe halfway through Act Three. And people told me it can't be done. You can't do a film without dialogue. And I said, no, of course you can, but.
Well, yeah, it's called silent movie, and it's been around for a while.
Yeah, but like, at least they had subtitles and pianos.
Yeah, but also, you know, one of the things though is that with silent cinema, people, you know, they have music and everything, but people got up, walked around, talked, nattered, did everything, and they just watched the movie. It just happened. It was never really a people sitting there staring. But that's an aside. That was a tangent.
That was a good first question. Come on up here and grab one of these.
Yeah. Not us. Grab one of these.
Yeah, grab one of these microphones.
Yeah. Yeah.
Just whatever one you want.
Yeah, preferably the black and white one. They're all black and white.
Yeah, no problem.
Thank you. So, Jim,
incentives to ask questions.
So, Jim, what did you watch this week? Kind of do a little comic book man thing here.
What did I watch this week?
Yeah.
Well, I have I had horror author Melanie McCurdy and the lady who makes those giant VHS tapes over. A major horror fan, Susan here. Oh, by the way, if you remember VHS and you miss VHS and you want any movie, put on one of those. They're lightweight. They're made to hang on a wall. Susan's right there. You can order them. They're relatively inexpensive, and they look great in a man cave.
Don't try to play them though.
But yeah. What did I watch this week? We started off with Bloodsucking Freaks, known by various titles, The Incredible Torture Show, and it was originally called Sardu, Master of the Screaming Virgins. It's essentially a ripoff of Herschel Gordon Lewis's Wizard of Gore, and the fact that Herschel didn't sue them is amazing to me. Ladies, what did... Well, it was hysterical. Yeah, the acting was what you'd expect from 1973, low budget. The gore effects weren't all that great, but there was a really cool, sadistic midget. And Troma released, they bought the rights and they released it.
Sadistic midget.
And they said, we have restored a scene. that was thought to be lost forever. How do we describe that scene? Implied.
Height restriction.
Implied. Gay. Midget oral sex, which they could have left out of the movie, and I'd have been satisfied. And they use the original title, Sardou, Master of the Screaming Virgins. It's an all right movie to watch. You know, it's fine. It's worth a laugh. And then we watched a Paul Naschy werewolf film called the Wolfman and the Yeti, which was really kind of a good movie. It made the Video Nasty list back in the day. Mostly because of, I guess, one scene where some skin is flayed off. And it doesn't look real. It looks 1973 real or so. Not a bad film. If you've ever seen Paul Naschy Wolfman films, Paul made probably the most Wolfman films in history. I think he made something like 35, 40 of these Wolfman films. And they're reasonable. The production values are good. The budget in $1970 dollars must have been pretty, well, still probably pretty high. You know, location shooting and all sorts of things. So it's worth watching. I think that's all I watched this week.
That's all you watched?
No.
No baseball or hockey or anything? Or
no. No hockey.
Oh, okay.
No baseball.
Okay. I watched A Quiet Place during the week, and there was another one that I did. I have to keep this on the computer for some reason so that I can actually talk a little bit spiffy about it. It's an Iranian film. It was one of the people at the convention actually produced it. Elijah Wood. He was one of the associate producers of it. And it's called A Girl Walks Home Alone at Night. It's basically a vampire story, shot in Iran. And it's about a vampire who kills men who disrespect women. And she's a female.
That's a big task.
It's wonderful. Like, I suggest it openly. It is available on streaming services. I'm not going to give the names of those because they're not going to give us money for them. Some of them perhaps shouldn't be mentioned because they're not legal. Did I say that? But it's shot in black and white. It was directed by a female director, too. I can find her name a bit later, but I heartily recommend it. If you like gore, which, honestly, I'm squeamish about gore. I will not watch a cannibal film. I will not watch any of those pictures. I will not watch any of the so-called medical revenge horror pictures. I will not watch. I'm sensitive, personally, to roadkill. So I have a big thing about that. And this one was very, very tasteful in terms of the blood that was shown. I heartily recommend it. The composition, the music, the characters. Shot modern day in terms of there's a drug dealer that does some pretty cool stuff. And it's pretty open film, but I recommend A Girl Walks Home Alone at Night if you get a chance to see it.
I will say this, it is on Netflix. And the reason I'm saying this is because I have a series being considered by Netflix. I love you, Netflix. I love you. Please buy my series. Sorry, had to get that in there.
Can I just throw a question out to the... we have a studio audience here. Normally, we have about 1,000 people for our podcast, but this is a little more than that. Right, Jim?
Because
usually we have a lot. And
it's growing weekly or monthly.
Yes, it's like creeping ulcerations.
Is that another podcast, like Sinister Inclinations?
A general question, sort of cast your minds back to when you first had exposure to a horror film. Was there a particular favorite, or was there a particular film that you first saw that went,
yes, you know, I like what I see, or something, you know, from your childhood, not the actual event, please, because we don't want to put anybody into trauma. But if there's something that people have seen that went, this is a very interesting thing, read a magazine, saw a book. Yes.
When I was little, I was at my friend's 10th birthday sleepover, and her parents were nurses, so we were alone because they were working night shift. And we watched Nightmare on Elm Street. It was my first ever experience of a horror movie, and I still am traumatized anytime I see one of them.
Wow, that was that the first Nightmare, the first film, or I guess.
I didn't watch any of the rest of them after that. Oh.
did you sleep after?
No, we did not.
So.
Because we were on waterbed.
That's I. What strikes me about Nightmare on Elm Street, I always remember the school bus thing. I never, still to this day, when I on a bus that drives erratically, not that people in Calgary drive erratically, bus drivers, I go, it's Freddy Krueger, you know, at the wheel. Anyone else? Oh my goodness.
He's carrying by a leg. Mm-hmm. He's very attracted to her. He's running and she's hiding behind a tree. The villain, the monster, whatever, he reaches out with a knife, cuts her throat. She swallows and the blood comes out, and it was so realistic. It was frightening, but it was just very, it was so matter of fact that it was just shocking, you know. That's the one scene that stayed with me forever, just as a, and it made me interested in, like, practical effects.
Wow. You know, it's funny because on Friday the 13th, I watched Friday the 13th for, I don't know, the 30th, 40th time. And it's funny you should mention that, because in the theater, that is the scene that kind of just changed my horror life. When I went, wow, you know? Because at that point, you know, I knew of Tom Savini, but I'd never seen anything that, like you say, that realistic. It's amazing. And, you know, to recreate it these days is very simple. It's not the hardest thing in the world, but back then it was revolutionary. And, it was that, and for me it was Dawn of the Dead, Romero's Dawn of the Dead. That was just crazy violent, you know, it's like, oh, okay, you know, and those two kind of, because I'd watched Herschel Gordon Lewis films, I'd watched a lot of films at the drive-in, things like that, Frogs with Ray Milland, but never anything so visceral. And that really shifted my perspective on what could be done in a horror film, so, yeah.
If you want visceral, if you want to talk about violence, the last scene in Bonnie and Clyde, 1968, with Peckinpah, doing his, you know, that's a non-horror film, but it was just, that's a scene that sort of sticks out. Anyone else, like, have a sort of a little feel or a memory or anything, and be it a book or?
The Hills Have Eyes?
Mm. Yes, yeah.
12 years old, watching it at a friend's house, and, like, underneath, first time I ever watched a scary movie, and I was terrified the whole way, and then they were all dead, and I was like, okay, they're all safe. And it zooms out into the goggle binocular, and the rest, I will not drive in the desert without a full tank of gas.
It's interesting, all these memories, like, are from the 70s horror pictures. And do you think anything around today? Like, do you still actively go to these and watch these? Do you think anything today has this impact, or it's not karaoke?
Where it was really slow in the beginning, and it kind of just felt very normal, and then in the last 30 minutes, it was just
terrifying for me at the end. But I like the aspect of the humor coming in with the horror as well. Mm-hmm. I find that quite enjoyable. So
cool, mm-hmm. cool. It's like a lot of these comments too, Jim, we've noticed is that it's like terrifying for me, you know, which is mm-hmm. pretty cool, you know, mm-hmm. because somebody else goes, oh, that's nothing. You know, I've done this, I've done that. You know,
yeah.
I cut my head off and everything and put it back in my head, you know. Yeah, that's fear is very personal for some.
Yeah, just there is fine.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, wonderful.
Were you a True Blood fan at all? Pardon? Were you a True Blood fan at all?
Yes.
Come here.
Jim will give you a vial of his blood. I will open a vein. A vintage lore to be mined.
Oh, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
It's an empty white roll with an elastic band, right? That was a cruel joke.
Yeah, it is kind of funny, okay.
I was telling Terry earlier that when I in the 70s, same as most of us who have been affected by their first scary movie, it was called Don't Be Afraid of the Dark, which has absolutely nothing to do with that schmaltzy TV series that I kind of watched a couple times and went, this has nothing to do with that movie. But that movie was a couple buys a house, and the landlord or the person who sold them the house says, whatever you do, do not open the chimney that's been all boarded up down in the basement. And of course, you know, that's like saying, don't touch that to a kid. So the husband leaves out of town, and she's by herself in the house quite often. And the critters from down in hell decide that... well, they need more souls, so but they can't look at light. They cannot stand the light. So whenever she's in a room, they try to sneak to get the light off, and there's one particular scene where she's in the shower and the light's on, and they come creeping out of the cupboard, but they can't look at the light, so they use a hanger to click off the light switch, and it's just like, oh my God. And then she freaks because she knows they're after her and then flicks the light on and then you see them creep back into the cupboard. It's like it affected me so much after I watched it. It was those afternoon shows, the matinees, whatever they were called, mm-hmm. at 1 p.m. I think I skipped school or something and watched it. But then after the movie was over, I could have swore I saw some of those red people in my house.
Thank you. That's... a local actress, producer, and she's been kind of the star of our Blood Mania promotional film. That's Miss Angela White. I think there's, you know, something that, like you say, horror is a very subjective thing.
Well, it also encompasses more now. You know, we're at a comic expo, and there's comics, there's visual arts, there's lots that is out there. You know, some people even say the news is horrible, which it is.
But I do want to add one thing. What I love about Herschel Gordon Lewis and some other films that are out there that you were mentioning is when you have that comic relief mixed in with it, it's not so... You're not so affected by it that it's going to have, you know, you're freaked out and it's going to affect you for the rest of your life. You've seen those movies before.
Yeah, that actually works well, you know.
Yeah, we try for shock, and then something to bring the audience a little bit of humor and shock, and you know, so yeah, that's
the roller coaster of writing.
Well, it's overall entertainment, yeah. You know. And if Herschel ever said, you know, if Herschel said it's got to be entertaining. It doesn't have to cost $30 million or $300 million to produce, but it should be entertaining.
Or $30,000 in therapy for the next 3 years.
Yeah.
Yeah, or, you know...
Or as Herschel would have you believe. He was... I love Herschel Gordon Lewis's early posters. He was... after he left filmmaking, he went on to write 30 books about marketing. He was a marketing specialist. He's one of only three people that's in the American Marketing Hall of Fame. So he had these taglines that were just wonderful for posters. we warn you not, if you're a pregnant mother, if you're, if you have a heart condition, do not view this film under any circumstance,
Hey, that's like William Castle. If we're going into that, with the having nurses outside, for films like The Tingler, which still, how many actually know the Tingler? It's with Vincent Price, and they tell the actual audience to scream, scream, scream for your life. They actually
scream, Satan, scream.
Yeah.
That would be, that's something to put in a horror movie. Just little cues, scream now.
Hey, actually, that I don't recall the picture that it was in, but there was one. I remember it said, "If you hear the horror horn," and it said, "Boop boop 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 boop," be prepared for a shock. And it would be to show this guy getting out of a carriage, and then went boop 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 boop, and then something happened. Mm-hmm. And you were required to said, "If you don't want to see it, duck behind the theater seat."
Did you duck?
No, I prefer chicken.
duck and cover.
No, duck is tough and greasy.
The only, I think the only time I ever saw anything like that was in a Hungarian film called I Stand Alone, which back in the day when video and sound was around, you could actually find those things quite easily. But if you ever get a chance to, seeing a copy is going to be tough. It's subtitled, it's foreign, where do you find it, right? It's not going to be sitting in HMV. It's not going to be sitting in Sunrise Records.
Are we all movie fans here? Is it mostly movie, mostly film, or we can shift a little television? I think television's taken over a big role in the selling of
horror, let me finish shock. This up and we'll get to that. In the last 15 minutes of I Stand Alone, titling comes up, screen goes black, and it says, "The following 15 minutes are highly, highly disturbing. We're warning you, if you wish to leave the theater now, please do so." And they delivered. In so many ways, that last 15 minutes, they delivered. But I think that's the only time I've ever seen it. So, do we have television horror fans here? And if so, what do you watch?
Television.
Walking Dead? Fear of the Walking Dead?
I haven't started watching that one yet, but I plan to.
Yeah, it's like a, it's all right. Not as good. They really try so hard to make you care for the characters, but you just can't. Half of them you go, "Oh, please, go zombies,"
My question with The Walking Dead is, you're a fan of it? Have you watched Walking Dead from the beginning and that? Please tell me what the appeal is. I'm sorry, I'm not a fan. I'm not a fan of the books, like the 400 page. Please tell me what the appeal is. Okay.
Well, the thing about it is, it's actually, you get a glimpse into, a lot of movies will try, zombie movies, to give you a glimpse of what it would actually be like. But as you see it ongoing, and what happens to the characters, and their troubles, and their, people die, that's part of it, and how they respond to that, and it's the character interaction, really. Were you satisfied with this season? Do you think it's getting old, or?
Yeah, I think they need to change it up. I think they've lost some fans this past couple of seasons. From what I hear, there's a new showrunner,
Well, I think The Walking Dead, the turning point was when they, Negan killed Glenn. But you go, it's not the showrunner's fault. Robert Kirkman wrote that for the graphic novels, so it's part of the story. A little bit. Yeah, but slightly. I mean, there is no Daryl in the graphic novels. So the lad characters here and there, but they generally stick to it quite nicely. But I don't know. It's getting a little bit old, I think. And I'm very surprised Andrew Lincoln is still there, because after season 7, generally speaking, their salary demands go way up. But you can't get rid of Andrew Lincoln. I think, you know, and if anybody's standing at the end of the whole thing, it'll be Rick. So we shall see.
You see the guy with the baseball bat?
Negan. Negan. Oh.
Okay.
Yeah. The way I want the series to end is for Rick to wake up and he's still in the hospital room. And he's got Michonne there as a nurse. And it's just basically a takeoff of Wizard of Oz. I had a dream. You were there. And you were there.
Maybe he comes out of a shower.
Yeah. Yeah. I'd probably... Was anybody watching Ash versus Evil Dead? Okay. See, that's... Starz canceled it last week. And, you know, it's funny because a lot of Evil Dead fans would bitch about it all the time. Well, it's not exactly canon, and it's not this, and it's not that. Now they're bitching because it got canceled. It's like, you have to support these things. If you want horror on TV, support it.
At the end, when, you know, the hand comes up and everybody in the room jumped, my only response was, I want to do that. Mm-hmm. And I actually succeeded in that last year when I had a publisher up for 3 days after reading one of my books. So, yes.
Mm-hmm. It's a lot like, I suppose, a lot of independent filmmaker.
Mm-hmm.
You know, trying to get it out to festivals and hoping people will see it. And if they do see it, you know, off it goes. Sometimes it'll play, you know, it'll go directly to DVD. But, you know, it's one of those things, like, if you manage to get it on Netflix or you manage to get it on Amazon or you manage to get it on YouTube Red or any of the platforms, you still have to hope because there's so many of them. You know, that's really the problem.
You know, for writers especially, it's not easy to get a contract from the big companies anymore. You really are sort of stuck doing the self-publishing thing, and that's fine. It's great because we have a really great little community out there for self-published authors. I'm hoping that as the industry changes a little bit, it'll make it much simpler for people who do enjoy writing and filmmaking, screenplay writers, all of that will have a better market and more open market for us.
Good. How many books have you written now?
I just finished number 11. Just like 2 days ago. I think.
Oh, you finished it. Good.
I finished it. So now it's, you know, more editing. Yay! And, you know, the decisions on whether to split it into different portions, there's a whole lot involved with it.
Do you not find that self-editing is self-defeating?
At times, certainly. When you're looking at 80 to 100,000 words, it gets, you can't. You just can't look at it anymore. So that's when you have to hand it off to somebody to read it. Hopefully you'll find somebody that enjoys your genre. You know, that makes things a little difficult when you don't.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm a perfectionist. I like to have as much done properly as I can before I hand it off to somebody who's gonna take a red marker and make a mess of your baby. Mm-hmm.
So that's why you never want to let a director near an editing suite, you know, because the director thinks everything he shot is brilliant, you know. But does it play? That's the problem.
Yeah.
You know, why did you cut that scene out? Well, it sucked. And it, no, well, you know, there are scenes that you shoot sometimes that just can't, it makes, you know, it doesn't add to the narrative. Mm-hmm. And if, you know, I mean, if you've shot like a 3.5 hour movie, well, you've got to cut that down, you know, unless it has Thor in it. but the problem with independent film these days, and I think that a lot of the best horror films right now are coming from, has anybody seen Victor Crowley? Mm-hmm. It's the latest in the Hatchet franchise. And Adam Green has made the film. And I watched Jigsaw, the Saw sequel, and I watched Victor Crowley. So they're both sequels, and you can tell which one had the money. It's just so apparent. And you would think that Victor Crowley, because of the violence, would have better effects, but it didn't. And so everything all comes down to budget. And the problem with that is, if you're an independent filmmaker, you can have your movie out there, but you don't have studio money to promote it. You know, if I could just get one commercial on during The Walking Dead,
yeah,
just one, you know, available now on Blu-ray and DVD, I'd be the happiest guy in the world. But who's got that kind of money? You know, it would probably cost you for one spot probably $75,000. So, you know, unless you've got backing, you know. And I, you know, it's not like, you know, hey, Jason Blum, would you just, you know, throw me some cash for that? You know, it doesn't work, you know. So the independent filmmaker's got a much harder, and see, I think the studio horror films, a lot of them don't understand horror. You know, you keep getting the retelling of the same story. It's either the Amityville story, or, you know, it's a generic haunted house, a generic monster. And the unfortunate part, I think, for us horror fans is that people begin to believe that is what horror movies are. And they've never gone back and watched. But the thing that I'm really enjoying right now is, because of Stranger Things, all of a sudden people are starting to rediscover 80s films again. So you're seeing a lot more Netflix projects, things like that, go right back to the 80s, like The Babysitter. There's a film called Beyond the Gates with Barbara Crampton. That's superior, you know? So that's starting to make a comeback, which I think is good for the genre.
I saw a smile
there,
so Beyond the Gates is a good one.
No, I was just thinking, you know, all this talk about independent film and budgets and everything. I think that the studios have done a pretty slick way of, basically they've outsourced it, if you really look at it. Years ago, the studios used to have B picture units and C picture units, where people were trained how you make film, and a lot of independent film, as you've seen because of your zombie site and everything, is frankly not very good. I'm talking not very good in terms of horror content or effects or anything, but everybody has to learn, and this is a training ground for people. And because of the plethora of filmmakers out there, anybody with a video camera can be a filmmaker. And anybody with a digital camera is a photographer. So as people learn their craft, and it takes time to learn, then this offers a tremendous outlet. And the studios have it down pretty well. They'll let you come to us if you want the marketing, if you want the placement, but you have to be this style. You have to be this way. You have to know how to make film.
Well, it has to fit the, you know, very basic criteria, but it's an important criteria.
Yeah, yeah. And then we will give you the money to do it. And just because you get money, it doesn't mean it's going to be a good picture. Because we've seen lots of big budget mistakes. And we pay for it when we go to the movies when we pay the large prices and we buy the popcorn, that's how they end up paying for the failures. But for every new picture or every big picture, it's mega marketing and it's mega money. So there's a lot more to lose.
True, but I think if you didn't even put a dollar into promoting the Avengers, people would still go.
Well, because it's the Avengers.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. You know, so and really, I mean, there's two genres that actually allow the studios to make the big budget films. One is horror. There's always, you know, a horror movie is going to bring in a certain amount of money and good rom-coms. And I'm trying to figure out a way to combine the two, and it's eluding me so far. But
I might have something for you.
Romantic comedy with blood.
Axes are sexy too. Just saying.
The Return of the Heartless Dead. How about that?
There you go.
The Ambivalent Dead. That's what I wanted to make. Should I eat you? I don't know. Maybe let's stay in tonight and not hunt anybody. What do you think?
So what we try to do, we never try to bash filmmakers.
No.
Because I have a great deal of respect for anybody who goes out, completes a film. It's a hard, arduous task. It really is.
He's the patron saint of Ed Wood.
Yeah. But so if you've got the moxie to go out there, make the film, get it out there, you know, kudos.
And word of mouth makes a big difference.
Now, having said that, there are some bad films. So the next question I'm going to ask is, what's the worst horror film you've ever seen?
Get Out.
The Chucky series.
Oh, you know, like Chucky.
Yeah.
Geez, did you see the Cult of Chucky, the latest?
No, I haven't seen anything. It's all from the 80s.
Yeah, it's
The
Cult of Chucky. Yeah, and there's not as much Chucky in it as usual. And it just, there's really, it's pointless. There's no reason for it. And I think after Child's Play 2, there was really, that was it. You know, because I didn't mind the first Child's Play because it was inventive. You hadn't seen it before. You know, I'm the little bugger running around, you know, with a knife. You know, I like the idea, you know.
More comedy than when I was watching it than horror.
Mm-hmm. Anyone else have a disastrous movie they watched?
I heard that you.
Disastrous, so much as disappointing. Where, in a way, like I would almost take a colossal failure over something that's just meh. Especially, like, I'm thinking of, speaking of Netflix, The Vault. Where I went in so prepared to love this movie. This should have been my movie because it had two things I love, spooky stuff and zany heist things. Because it's, I don't know if people know the premise again, it's like a little indie thing, but basically it is about a bank robbery, except for once they find out as the bank robbery is in place, it takes place in this old bank and the vault is super haunted. So I was so prepared to love this movie. It should have been everything I love, nothing I hate. And it just was this meandering, poorly acted mess where I just want to wrestle it away and give it to someone good. Like, just, you could have had it all.
You see, I don't mind really bad horror films because, I don't know, it's almost like Mystery Science Theater. Because when we sit there, we'll riff on it, you know. And it's kind of fun, you know. I don't mind a terrible horror movie. Has anybody ever seen a movie called American Movie? It's about a fellow named I can't remember his first name. His last name is Borchardt, and he wants to make a film called Coven. And of course, in the film, it's pronounced Coven. No, it's Coven. But he's got no experience at filmmaking. He's got no money. But it's his dream. And it's a documentary about his story, and he finally gets the movie made. And if you want a good insight into an independent filmmaker wannabe's life, that's the one. Sometimes it's hard to watch. It'd be like watching William Hung, a documentary about him wanting to win American Idol.
Not if you're William Hung's mother.
Oh no, you sing well. You sing well, William. Yeah. It's well worth the watch. And you know, you see a lot of there's a lot of people out there who think it's easy. You know, hey, well, I'll just get my buddies. I've got this camera. I'll get my buddies, and I know a girl who does some makeup. And well, why don't we make a zombie film? Because a zombie film would be easy. You don't, you know, the makeup should be easy, you know. But so you go, okay. So the guy writes a script, and let's face it. I mean, there's only really maybe. Well, let's face it. It's all the same story. A zombie outbreak. People try to survive the zombie outbreak.
Oh, don't spoil it, Jen. Jeez.
Well, now
spoilers here. And so you see, literally, it's like horror novels on Amazon. I used to review them. I've reviewed 400 odd zombie films. And I've got a hard drive still with another 400. And I've almost given up. And I swore to myself I would review every zombie film made. I wasn't expecting this. You know, I would have thought The Walking Dead would have killed the zombie movie genre. Because what more can you do? You know, I can't go out and make a zombie movie that's going to be any better. I can't develop the characters the way The Walking Dead has in 90 minutes. You know, I don't have Nicotero doing my special effects. You know, so what can I do that would be better than The Walking Dead? And I can't think of anything, you know. All I can, there's a short zombie film I want to make that has never been done, and I can guarantee you that. You'd like it. Just think Team America. My review is the 2005 film Die, You Zombie Bastards. Ever wanted to see a villain who looks like a cross between the Emperor from Star Wars and Witchy Poo from H.R. Puff and Stuff get his penis beaten with hammers by three green topless zombie women for his sexual pleasure? Neither did I. But that's just one of the lowlights that this film provides. When the selling points on a DVD cover are that the music is provided by a member of the Butthole Surfers, and there are cameos by aged porn legend Jamie Gillis and Psycho Billy artist Hazel Atkins, one should immediately recognize that this is not indicative of quality assurance. What a fucking mess. Lloyd Kaufman would laugh at you if you asked him to distribute this. The hubris, the conceit it would take to film this script fully believing that people would enjoy, laugh, and pay money to see it is tantamount to insanity. If you think that I just don't get it and you're a fan of this film, you are a cretinous, lowbrow product of incest who would be equally happy observing a shiny object. I'm not afraid to say it. This film is actually a sequel to Red's Breakfast 2, Dawn of the Red, which I would rather stick my dick in an active beehive while listening to Nickelback than ever view. The film introduces serial killer Red Tool to audiences as portrayed by Tim Gertzmar. Gertzmar is to acting what Terry Schiavo was to football. Here, Red's girlfriend Violet is kidnapped by Baron Nefarious. Nefarious lives on Hell Island in the Bermuda Triangle, where he plans to unleash his enormo Zombotron on an unsuspecting populace, mutating them into the living dead. Red turns into a superhero, wearing a costume made largely from the skins of his victims, and goes on a journey to rescue his love. Along the way, he meets an alien played by Gillis, who resembles Anthony Bourdain's older, simple brother, and others who help him on his quest. His tribulations are replete with the lamest of scatological and dick gags, all leading to a ridiculous conclusion. I won't even get into aspects such as direction or effects, as there really are none to speak of. This is not a zombie film, as the title suggests, and it's not as bad as some that I have or will review here. It is, though, an utter waste of 90 minutes of your life that not even copious, gratuitous nudity can save. Woe unto you if you ignore this.
Camp Bloodbath is the granddaddy of all campsite slasher films. Max's mom plays Nancy, this shy girl next door.
Nice legs. What time they open?
It's cool you get to remember your mom this way.
At least I get to see her on the anniversary of her death, even if she is being chased by a psycho.
Somebody's coming.
Hey, do you guys know the way to Camp Bluefinch?
Tina.
So we're in the movie.
Oh, hi. What's your name?
Max. Best summer ever!
Anyone want to help me pick some strawberries?
Nope, but I'll give you a hand with those melons. Talking about her boobs.
Ew, writing is so bad.
What is that noise?
It's Billy. He's coming. Everyone who has sex in this movie dies. It's awesome.
No sex.
Run! Wait, wait, wait. Selfie time.
Okay. You. How do we get out of here?
Movies like this end when the final girl kills the bad guy and the credits roll.
That's Paula. That's the final girl. We just have to stay with her till the end of the movie.
Oops.
I want no more than keep the hard work. I want chainsaws and big-ass knives, and I want them now.
Guys, what's happening? Why am I colorblind? Am I having a stroke?
We're in a flashback.
I wonder if all this blood is just corn syrup, you know? Like, these characters are walking around with just corn syrup in their veins.
Oh,
no. Oh, God, that's blood.
I know in the movie you're supposed to die, but that doesn't mean you have to, right?
What do we do now? We fight.
We really want to do it. Who's seen The Final Sacrifice? Mystery Science Theater made it famous. It's a film shot in Calgary. Yeah. I know the fellow who played Zap Rowdowser. He lives here in Calgary. And I really want to do a short film sequel to that. You know, so there's a lot of ideas out there that can be done and done well, you know. But they intended The Final Sacrifice to be a serious film. But there'd be a lot of comedic aspects to it. So, I mean, that's what I want to make. I want to make films, television, that's horror, like Ash versus Evil Dead. A healthy combination of horror and comedy. It's, you know, just all around entertainment. You know, and so it's finding the right scripts is sometimes difficult, but because you ask somebody, you know, the worst thing is, can you be funny? Yeah, I can be funny. You get the first draft and go, I thought you said you could be funny. You know, but I digress.
That was a tangent. As the tangent wears thin, we realize. Visual horror. I really don't like using that word, horror, all the time. Visual fear, let's call it. Does anybody out there read the horror comics? Like, good, like, yeah. Yeah. What perchance?
I really like Revival. That was a lot of fun. Mm-hmm. I have had a lot of fun with the Hellboy comics. I've got that whole run. I don't know. Litterbomb came out pretty recently, and that's like a really fun commentary on celebrity and how that can, in some cases, literally eat you alive. There's a lot out there. Like if you look, it's out there, and you can find something to your taste.
It's huge. Like, have you had a chance to see Archie? The Archie spinoffs?
Afterlife with Archie.
Yeah.
Those are really good, but they come out so infrequently, it's hard to get really invested. The Chilling Tales of Sabrina, supposedly we're getting a TV show. I don't know how they're going to do that, as I think there's 10 issues of the comic out. But they're excellent, they're well worth waiting for, but they take so long.
There's one called The Haunt of Horror. Have you seen that? It's published every 2 months, and they go back and they reprint very well, I might add, the EC stories and Strange Tales and everything.
Cool.
I think it's $5 for an issue or something. They come out every few months, and you can read something from 1953, you know, Strange Tales, you know, which is pretty cool. There's so much out there. American Vampire was one.
Yes.
You know, all of these. And The Walking Dead is, what, 400 issues or something?
It's only 127.
Something like that. So, that's not a good sign.
Oh,
Robert wants to ask a question.
I just want to extend this microphone so I can move it to people.
Oh, okay. All right.
See, it's different than when I was growing up, and I think I'm going to age myself here. But we had, when I was very young, we were stuck with Famous Monsters of Filmland. I won't say stuck, it was a great magazine. Eerie, creepy, things like that. And then as it went on, Marvel, and to a lesser extent, DC, started with their horror. You know, Mobius, the vampire. Werewolf by Night, stuff like that. So it's a much better market today, you know, if you really want to read some horror. Have you read The Harvester at all by Steve McGinnis? Have you read 68? It's a zombie comic by Nat Jones.
It's not my jam.
Garth Ennis stuff, Crossed and everything, which is just, it's brutal. Like the things that he does in a book, that was 100 issues. And I'm going, I read like 4 and I'm going, my goodness me.
A buddy of mine in Kelowna turned me on to one, and it was something about this psychotic killer, and it was drawn very crudely.
Well, that's new.
No, it was very crudely, and it was something about...
That sounds fun.
Yeah, it's something rather...
Johnny the Homicidal Maniac?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, it's like, okay, this is kind of interesting, you know?
Yeah. I actually haven't read any of that, but I did have a bunch of friends who were super into basically all that stuff in high school, so that I kind of lump it in with that point of my life.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, even getting away from visual stuff, do you guys do horror podcasts at all, like audio horror? Or?
Not audio.
Yeah.
Just video. Okay. Oh, listen to them.
Yeah, listen to them.
You know, when I tend to, I listen to old time radio.
Okay. Yeah.
But no, there's a few. Certain ones, like I get interviewed by them a lot.
Okay, yeah.
So if I like the format and I like the people, yeah, I'll go back and I'll listen. Creeper Cast is all right. There's a few.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of Pseudopod and, what am I thinking of? The No Sleep Podcast. I really like them. I don't know, there's just something, there's like an intimacy to like lying alone in the dark with someone just telling you stories in your ear. Like that's...
No, I still like the old-time radio stuff. Any time. Have you heard the one that is done here in Calgary on CKUA?
I don't think so.
What's it called, Terry, that Stuart was saying? It's Tales from...
The Script.
No. Tales from the Script.
I always thought that was a cool title, Tales from the Script, and somebody used it.
I might have to check that out.
It's called Hemlock something Drive. But it's the first live horror broadcast in Canada. And very good stories. They wanted me to write one and
wasn't the Rue Morgue used to do stuff like that, the magazine. But maybe it was more, it had a podcast and it was I don't know if it was live or not, and then they had their whole radio station pounding death metal out and other stuff. But I don't know if that's still going now.
There used to be an old one years ago. It would play at like, okay, this is in the 80s, like 83, 82. It'd be at like 11 o'clock to 11:20 or 11:20 to midnight or something. And they'd tell these horror stories late at night on the radio. I don't know what station it was back then. I can't even remember.
Was it CBC?
I don't remember.
Because CBC used to do one.
But they were really good. And they put me to sleep. Like, they were good. Yeah. They were suspenseful, but yeah.
CBC Ottawa used to do one. It was by a news announcer called Brian Smith. And it was called Gotcha. And they used the theme from Rosemary's Baby. Some of the music. Yeah. And he read classic tales, classic stories, like Lafanu, William Hope Hodgson, all of these.
And was that CBC?
Yeah, it was CBC.
Radio.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it was, you know, he would have go into lines like, "Snuffling shadows just beyond the firelight. What is that?" And it'd be silence. And you'd go, "Ooh!
Oh, yeah.
Gotcha."
I don't know if that was it, but they'd have these funny special effects, and then, you know, the woman had a car crash, and they'd have, it sounded great. Yeah. The special effects were great, too.
Sound effects, and everything. I mean. Yeah.
I'm not being rude. I'm trying to find the name of this locally produced horror cast.
Perhaps it's a lesson in promotion when we can't find local stuff and it takes a while. You know, let's be accessible to people, you know.
We have such a big community here in Calgary and area. It would be much easier.
Well, you know, speaking generally about fans and fan communities, sometimes they can get very, very insular. And people get almost tribal in their their likes and dislikes. If you walk around with, say, a Cannibal Holocaust shirt, you are not a death metal fan. You are not a comic fan. People tend to cluster in that sort of a way, which is a shame because people should, again, be working together to promote their common idea of shock or whatever they would like. I'm speaking that too, like music's very tribal. When you walk around with your band t-shirt on, you know, people come up to you, "Oh, you like this, blah, blah, blah," you know, and you know, "Oh, you like this, well, I don't like you," this sort of thing. So what are you walking around with a Justin Bieber shirt on for? Sorry, Justin, if you see this, love you, baby.
No. I like Justin.
You know, hey, we got it. This could be international. We don't know who sees this, you know. So we got to be kind. We got to be cruel to be kind sometimes.
I love you, Justin.
Yeah. So hey, you know,
I don't.
You know, he got a lot better lawyers than I do. So we gotta watch. You know, and we're not here, like Jim was saying before. We're not here to bash people, to bash filmmakers. These are simply opinions, feelings. If you agree with them, that's great. If you don't, that's great too. And I'm not responsible for your lack of education.
No, I'm just kidding. I love you, Justin Bieber. Bieber.
That's the Canadian version.
Cut.
Actually, love
I can't
the
find it. I'm
going to
say Dark Side Drive on CKUA. They're done for the season now, but they're going into another season. It's very well done.
That sounds
very
like
well done. Yeah, and actually, the one episode that they did, they record them, but there was one episode that was the first live horror broadcast in Canada in, I think, 80 years.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Which would be kind of cool to go and see, because apparently the studio has even the same types of microphones that they used to use back in the 1940s. Stuff like that. And they've got their sound effects guys, you know, with a cookie sheet for thunder, you know, and making all the sound effects right, you know, old style, the way it would have been done. So it's
the
really
Foley.
Yeah, all kinds of Foley things, yeah. What, yeah, we need the sound of a giraffe dying.
Just go to any major zoo.
That CKUA thing, is that right now? Or
It's over for the season, but it'll be coming back. I think they do about 12 episodes, 12 half-hour episodes. It just finished, so I have to say that they probably run from November and December.
Like once a week? Or
once a week, yeah. Weekly, yes, in the evenings. Yeah, better than noon. You don't want to be, you know, shocked, you know, while you're sitting at work, you know.
What, one of the things we were mentioning, too, about with film and all of that is crossovers. You know, a lot of people will say about horror being blurred now. So you can get, some people have said that Alien is a horror series. Some people know it's a science fiction series. We had a thing, I think, I forget the fellow, actually, he programs the films here.
Keith Coley?
Yes, we were talking about Blade Runner being a horror film. Mm-hmm. And I had said, no, it's an horror film because the way it's structured with the narration, the way, with the past, the present, the dark dialogue.
Well, I said it before, I'll say it again. If you were a replicant, it's a horror film.
No,
you know, because you know they got this guy who's setting, you know, Deckard's out to kill you.
It's noir.
You know, Deckard is a replicant serial killer. You know,
yeah.
So
it's, we have a point of disagreement here. it's the way that the original story, well, Android's Dream actually was a comedy. Mm. It was a satire, and the way that the film is done is. With the past, with the present narration, with that wonderful, almost dialogue at the end when, you know, when he says, you know, she can't survive, then again, who does? You know, and he's standing in the rain. You know, that's pure noir act, like desolation. But that's just my opinion on it.
Yeah, so.
We have to insert a commercial here sometime, don't we? Or are we not doing that anymore?
For fast, effective relief.
Later on, Jim will take a shower and we'll replicate the scene from Psycho.
Okay, with that, we're going to take a short break. We'll be right back. Hi, welcome back.
Here's your paper. I remember that in High Anxiety. Which is one of the few Mel Brooks ones that are actually witty when he does that scene in the shower, spoofs the scene in Psycho, when having a shower and goes in and starts beating the person with the newspaper. Mm-hmm. Here's your paper! You bang, bang, like this, and the person's screaming.
So anybody have a favorite horror comedy film?
Shaun of the Dead.
Good.
Army of Darkness.
Oh,
yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, that would be one of my favorites. Go ahead.
I think it's Tucker and Dale versus Evil.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. That's a good one.
Yeah.
That was filmed in Edmonton, correct?
And in Calgary.
Yeah, in Calgary.
Yeah. Our last guest, Dave Trainer, the guy who did the special effects, makeup effects for Blood Mania, and right now is up for an award for that, did Tucker and Dale. And so, yeah, he was, you know, if you walk into his workshop, which is his garage, you can see the legs and stuff from the wood chipper. Kind of cool. They don't look as impressive when they're, you know, you're holding them, but.
How about Blood Mania?
Yeah, that's my favorite.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, pitch it.
Blood Mania. Yeah. Richard Gordon Lewis.
Trust me, watch it.
I think horror comedy, going back, I don't know. There were certain scenes that were unintentionally funny in a lot of movies that I saw. If anybody's seen Amicus's Vault of Horror, it's an old anthology. And there's just a scene where this woman is just sick of her husband. And he comes walking in the door and says, "Why isn't this house ever clean? I told you to." And through the whole short film, you get to see her kind of being verbally abused. So the minute he starts in on her, she takes this claw end of a hammer and just screams and sticks it in his head. And I thought that was the funniest thing. And I'm sitting and I'm the only one laughing in the theater, you know? That happens sometimes in wrong, bad spots. And I'm looking around, oh, okay, I'm going to slunk down in my seat.
And you realize you're in your living room?
We've got one here.
You guys remember the name of the movie that was done by Waitiki out in New Zealand, which is a documentary, They Come from the Shadows and They're the Vampires? It just cannot come to the top of my head. It was on Netflix, and I saw it, and it's a comedy, but it was so dry documentary format.
Oh, What We Do in the Shadows?
Yeah.
Yeah, I love that film.
That was wonderful.
They're making it into a series.
They certainly should.
They certainly should. Yeah, definitely. What We Do in the Shadows. It's about four vampires of various ages who decide to room together. And it's a comedy. It's a horror film. It's a love story. You know, and I just love the ending of it, too. You know, there was something very romantic about the ending of it. You know, so, yeah. And I think the original cast is coming back as well, so that's something to look forward to. You know, yeah, actually, that's a good one. Have you watched any films recently that you would care to share, whether they were decent, not so decent? That didn't, yeah. Yeah, a horror film that.
Yeah, we offer free therapy here.
Yeah, it would be nice if there were a superhero zombie running around, right? You know, there's a genre that hasn't been done. Yeah.
Well, in the comics, what is it?
Zombies and Cowboys, wasn't it?
Yeah, with Zombie Spider-Man and Zombie. Yeah. Marvel Zombies, yeah.
There was the crossover. Just recently, DC Animation did Gotham Noir.
What?
It's called Gotham Noir.
Okay.
It essentially, it's Batman meets Jack the Ripper. And some of the DC animations, they have better stories than their live action stuff. And they're only about an hour and 15 minutes. And they're supposed to be for kids, some of them. But this was pretty violent. Poison Ivy makes an appearance as doing a Salome-like dance in it, in the opening credits. And it was, for an animated picture, there was a lot of blood in it. But I recommend Gotham Noir. Hmm. It's just out, it came out this year. It's only maybe about 4 months old.
Wow. You can definitely see how the mediums have changed over the years for horror.
Mm-hmm.
Because 1980s, I mean, it was film. That's where you went. But now it books and TV shows and
yeah, it's all TV. That stuff. TV plays a huge role in it. I think it reaches more audience than film. You know, you don't have to. You can, and with today's sophisticated television technology, people buying huge screens and stuff and everything, and people buying retro screens. You know, it's you just turn it on and it's there. So huge.
Yeah, well, you know, oddly. In certain areas of the country, TV sales are down. People will watch movies on this or this. It kind of amazes me because to me, I mean, a movie is a big screen experience. I just wish I could have one of those 80-inch screens in my home, you know, that would be. But then again, people would be knocking on my door constantly. Hi, I just bought a movie. Can I watch it? No.
Have you guys seen Dark Christmas?
Black Christmas.
Oh, Black Christmas.
Yeah.
Well, you know, I was close.
That was Dark Christmas.
I liked
that's,
that one.
That's Keenan Ivory Wayans did that?
No, superior to the remake and a Canadian film. Yeah. It's probably one of the most recognized Canadian films in the horror
genre.
It was
late at night, CBC. You know those movies where you start watching and get engaged, and then you're like, okay, it's 3, but I gotta keep watching till the end. I couldn't stop watching it.
And the nice thing about CBC is they don't cut them.
Yeah.
You know, there was a point years ago I was watching Magnum Force, the Dirty Harry film. And it was on CBC, and it was on an American station. The Americans left in, so I watched it twice. The Americans left in the violence, took out the nudity and the swearing. The Canadians left in the nudity and the swearing, but took out some of the violence. Huh. It's very odd, the way they cut them. Yeah, very strange. But, so anybody have any favorite Canadian horror films that they've...
She saw one, but she doesn't remember.
Yes, sir.
Meatballs.
No. Changeling.
Yes.
Yes, George yes. C. Scott.
Yes.
The
scariest
movie I ever saw.
Really?
Wow.
It freaks me out.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Oh.
Gotta have the chair. Yeah.
And well, there.
Mm-hmm.
Which is really good, which is more, for me, is the eeriness than the gore and the violence.
Mm-hmm.
I love watching gore and violence because I appreciate it and the work that goes into it. Because now I don't like the digital blood splatters.
Yeah, the CGI.
Yeah. I like the hands-on work that went into things, but that movie doesn't have any of that, and it freaks me out to the stage.
There goes the prize package for the Dean House.
I started watching a film the other night that was shot here in Calgary. It's a zombie film. I won't name it on here because a friend of mine wrote the screenplay and directed it. But when you see a zombie kill, they've got that CGI effect where the blood hits the lens of the camera. And that really annoys me. It really annoys me, you know? It's so fake looking. You know, I just love the practical work. That's
well, unless they had a digital hand wipe it off. And it bothers me that that doesn't make any sense.
We were talking on our last podcast. There's a movie shot in Vancouver, and where else was it?
Which?
Easter Bunny Massacre.
Oh, you're bringing that up again.
just because
let's oh right the
kill.
The chop hand sort of the Atlanta Braves.
It was shot in Delta and Vancouver.
Yeah, Delta.
And
right.
I would almost have preferred CGI. It contains one of the worst kills I've ever seen in a horror movie.
That wasn't a kill. That was a cooking lesson.
Well,
knife skills. That's all it was. Like
dude in a bunny costume has a cleaver. and he hits the guy in the head. And that's the only time you see the bunny use the cleaver. And it's an easy shot, right? Because what you do is you take a cleaver and you cut the shape of the head out and then hold it there so it looks like the cleaver is in the bone. Simple enough. So you see it hit, camera goes on the bunny. Now the guy in the bunny costume is going,
it's true. It's the Atlanta Braves chop.
And while he's doing that, there's somebody beside the camera who's got what I think is obviously like one of those red plastic ketchup bottles. And it's full of very fake looking blood. And he's squirting it on the bunny. So it's a stream just hitting this bunny. And you're like, this is terrible. This is one of the most awful things I've ever seen. Not by far the worst Canadian horror film I've ever seen, but it competes with Ferocity. anybody else have a favorite Canadian horror film? We've got Black Christmas. We've got The Changeling.
Visiting Hours.
Visiting Hours.
Well, Cube. Yeah. Is that Canadian?
Cube.
Cube.
Yeah. Yes, it is.
Yeah, and Martyrs too.
Yeah. Well, yeah, Martyrs was shot.
The original.
Okay. Yeah, Cube always stuck with me. I watched it many
Cube
years ago. Cube
the Superior. What did you think of the sequels?
I didn't see the sequels.
They're just more of the same and not as good.
That's what I kind of figured, so I wasn't going to go out of my way.
Yeah, no, Cuba, great film. I really enjoyed it.
You're right. There didn't need a sequel. Very simple, very scary, just that small set, just the way it was shot as well.
Well, the problem with that is the studio sees, hey, it made money. Want to do another? And you may not even have an idea for it as the producer or the writer. I can put one out there. And I think there was two sequels, and it just got progressively worse.
Really?
Canadian. What about the Scanners films, Cronenberg? I like the first Scanners. I didn't care much for each subsequent, Scanner Cop.
Burnt Offerings Canadian? Was it Burnt Offerings?
Prom Night, yeah.
Prom Night.
My Bloody Valentine.
I am very fond of Ginger Snaps.
Yeah.
Yes.
Ginger Snaps.
Yes.
Did you see the sequel?
I haven't yet. It's on my to-be watch list.
Yeah, actually, that's one where the sequels aren't bad.
Yeah. But no.
Yeah.
That was written by, actually, a guy in Calgary, co-wrote here. Stephen Mascott wrote he co-wrote the sequel to it. He was playwright at Alberta Theatre Projects for a while.
Okay, well, we have 3 minutes here. I want everybody who hasn't received something to come on up to the table.
It's not a kissing booth.
Yeah, it is a kissing booth. Come on up. We need some money to buy merch.
Yeah, we.
Just kidding.
Communicable diseases available here.
Okay, there's some photos there.
Yes.
We've got Mad Max. We've got The Gate. We have Tom Savini's remake of Night of the Living Dead. We've got some posters.
Yes.
Those are some Blood Mania posters. Make sure everybody gets one of those. And, let's see. Anybody like Charlie Band's Puppet Master stuff?
That's Frankenstein you have in your
hand. And I have a Frankenstein poster.
Which
one? The real original.
Oh, well, good stuff. Yes.
Yes.
Sir, you want to...
Oh, look at that.
Okay, and do you want a Blood Mania?
I got Blood Mania,
yeah.
Excellent. All right, folks, well, I'd like to thank you all for coming out today.
Thank you.
And we will...
thank you for our crew, too. Thank you, Robert, for doing your bit.
And we hope that we'll see you again. And hopefully we're not first in the morning.
Well,
a Saturday.
You should mention too about our video, our channel. We're available on the YouTube channel.
Yes, look up Sinister Inclinations on YouTube. All of our episodes are there. Like us on Twitter at SinInc33. Send questions if you'd like. Email us questions. We'll answer them on air. And if you like them, subscribe to the channel, share it around. That's all we ask.
And we'll go back now to the lights in the sky.
Okay. Well, thank you very much, folks.
Thank you.
Okay. Well, that was our Sinister Inclinations Live highlights. It was a lot of fun.
Yeah. It was good. Like, the people that were there were genuinely interested in it. And I applaud them for coming up, because some people don't like to speak in that kind of an environment.
That's true.
You know?
That's true.
You know, if they get shy, or we don't have any oxygen in the environment, so they keel over and presents for limit on some of their comments.
So we may do it again in Edmonton at the Edmonton Comic and Entertainment Expo. So watch out, Edmonton. We're coming. Not for very long. Just go into Edmonton and leave. Because Edmonton.
No, I'm gonna stay there. I'll probably end up staying a little longer. Do some of the sites. I haven't done the West Edmonton Mall in a long time, so that's gonna be a trip. Stunned.
I've never been.
Really? I'm gonna see if I can go there.
It's a giant mall with rides.
The food. The skating rink is pretty cool.
Well, I can imagine, but
skating rink's pretty cool.
If I want to go skating in September. So,
yeah, I think that's the water park. But anyway, we're not getting kickbacks from the Edmonton Chamber of Commerce to do this, but we will be up probably at the Comic Expo. Stop by if you have a moment. Stop by and say hello. Tell us that we're good. Tell us that we stink. You know, whatever you want to do, but just tell us something.
Yeah, and however, we may not be doing a plug for the Edmonton Chamber of Commerce or tourism, but Guy Fieri.
Yes.
If you're listening. We'd love you to invest in our podcast and projects.
I love your Big Blue Burger too, actually. And I've been to your place in, I should wear that next time, been to your place in Cancun and everything, which was pretty cool. Serious.
Yeah,
I bought stuff from your souvenir section that you had at the front of the store, this interesting shot glass like a skull, everything. So, I can drink a skull full of whiskey now.
Oh, gee, yeah. Well, yeah. When you were in Cancun,
Terry
brought me back
some lint,
a skull, and it can talk and shit.
Yeah.
Hi, I'm Jim Skull from Cancun.
Yes. Sinister Inclinations, actually. It looks like the logo for it.
Yeah, kind of.
Yeah.
So. Coincidentally, because it's a skull.
Yes.
Yeah. I guess next time around, we're going to have a paranormal investigator with us.
Yeah.
And he's going to explain, you know, we're going to, apparently, we'll talk about movies based on the paranormal.
Yes, I just got an idea. We should do the, you know what we should do? We should do, this be a secret. He's going to watch this or something. But I'll tell you something afterwards when the camera's off, so we didn't see how we should do this whole show. It'd be kind of different, at least for a moment or two. So,
what, are you talking about like a Charlie Brown fucking throw a fucking sheet over herself with holes?
That would be great. Just stand there with glasses on and everything, and just look at him.
And just stare at him. So, what do you have to say for yourself?
Who are you?
Yes. Yeah. Next time.
Yes. Yeah. Now that it's, you know, we don't. We don't drink on this show either. You know, because we don't do spirits. We don't retail spirits.
Yeah.
You know,
no. So. Well, I don't drink. So.
But
would that I could. We're gonna have we're gonna have James Shelley. He's a paranormal investigator, drummer for 13 Strikes, the horror band that Terry. Hits the sticks with and the drums. And
I've got blisters on my fingers from the last show. So, we'll be chatting with James about it. Going, like you said, about some of the films, the way that Poltergeist, Ghost Hunting, paranormal research is portrayed in the media. We can do a little bit of that.
Sure.
With him. And if you have any suggestions on that.
If you have any questions for a paranormal investigator.
Keep them to yourself.
No. Don't do that. Okay, yeah. Send them to us at the email right here.
Yes.
Yeah. Do spirit. We're hoping our editor's watching this. So he's actually paying attention.
Do spirit writing, though.
Yeah.
Wait, I feel like Karnak. We could do Karnak.
We could.
Karnak. We're going to do Karnak. You have to get the hat, and you have to, you know, what does it say?
We might get sued by Johnny Carson's people.
Yes. Well, we already got Guy Fieri. We already got...
We're just appealing to Guy's better... Guy seems like a very kind individual.
He is.
Who would probably like to see his wealth spread out for the benefit of the people.
Yes. Yes. I think so.
Guy.
Good food, man. Good food.
So, thank you for joining us.
Yes.
And we will see you next time around on Sinister Inclinations. Good night. Good day. Good afternoon. But don't let on, don't say to close my heart. I'll go down on my knees, cause it's a good to find. Mrs. Brown, you got a lovely daughter. What a fucking mess. Lloyd Kaufman would laugh. Fuck! Jesus Christ.
You rang?